It was hot that Saturday, unusually hot for May, and the church hall didn't have air conditioning. Mrs. Crumple asked Preacher Huffman to drive over to the funeral home in Diamond to pick up a box of shell-shaped cardboard fans with the grim reminder, "It's only his, her, shell," printed on the front. Earlier in the week, when I told Dad that I'd be playing Beethoven's Fur Elise in the recital, he looked up from his computer and said, "On the piano?" "Yeah," I said, "you should come." "How long's it going to last?" "An hour or so," I said. "It starts at 4 o'clock with a reception." I knew Dad didn't like to leave the house. He worried constantly about burglars. Whenever he went to the dump or junkyard, he wore at least 2 wristwatches so he could keep track of the time. He was convinced anyone who broke into our house would need at least an hour to find the best treasures, so he'd leave his collection unprotected for an hour, but rarely longer than that. "You don't practice much," Dad observed. We both looked at the piano in the corner of the living room. It was only partly visible under the heap of clothes, magazines, and a broken exercise bike. The piano bench was on the opposite side of the room. The TV was still parked on top of it. "Fur Elise isn't that hard to play," I lied. "Huh," Dad muttered. "Will Nola be there?" I wasn't expecting this. I didn't know how to answer. Did Dad want to see Mom? He couldn't. Otherwise, he would have thrown away his holy splinter months ago, when she asked him to. So why was he suddenly asking about Mom? "Mom?" I asked, stalling. I hadn't heard from her in weeks. "Yeah, is Nola coming?" What should I say? I searched my mind for an answer both vague and definitive enough to satisfy Dad. "When pigs fly," I said, taking a chance. Dad's mouth curled into the old familiar smirk. He insisted on riding his motorcycle to the recital, probably just to bug everyone. It would have been quicker to walk, but Dad wanted to show me how easily the motorcycle started now. "See," he said, pulling in the clutch and kick-starting the engine. "Kid stuff. Get on the back." The cleanup crew was waiting behind Carmen's casita. I never found out who all was there. I was told later that everyone who wasn't at the recital was instructed to meet at Carmen's at 4 o'clock sharp. Myron had my key to the house. Inside the church hall, my nerves turned to nausea when I saw the crowd. I was surprised how many people were there and how many I didn't recognize. They must have been from nearby towns. I looked around for Stormy, hoping I wouldn't see her. I didn't. Dad sat on a folding chair in the last row. He was fanning himself with the recital program and scowling. "You want some punch or cookies or anything?" I asked. "Nah," he said. "We'll have popcorn when this is over." His hair was long and greasy. His beard looked ratty. He was wearing his worn-out Star Trek t-shirt. I knew he wouldn't get cleaned up for the recital. I bet he hadn't taken a shower in a month. At 4:30, Mrs. Crumple began asking everyone to take their seats. All the performers, including me, sat in front of chairs, turned sideways to the audience so that we were facing the back of the piano. "Now, I know some of our performers are nervous," Mrs. Crumple told the audience. "Some might even feel butterflies in their stomachs." Butterflies? I had bats in my belly. "So let's remember," Mrs. Crumple continued, "to show our appreciation by applauding after every song." If I hadn't been so sick to my stomach with nervousness, I might have enjoyed seeing the Ants brothers in their clip-on ties. I had no idea they took piano lessons. They each played a classical song, and then as a trio, they performed a jazzy number called "Here Comes the Circus Train." Chance sang "All Aboard," while Lance hooted "Woo-woo," and Rance did some goofy leg movements that were supposed to mimic the wheels on a moving train. They didn't look nearly as mortified as I would have been. Truth is, they looked like they were enjoying themselves. Mrs. Verna Hertzel played a long number from the Nutcracker Suite. I didn't know that she took lessons. Even Preacher Huffman played "Simple Gifts." My brain kept jumping from the scene in front of me to what I imagined was happening at our house. What would people think when they saw how we lived? Some of the piles in the living room now reached the ceiling. It had gotten so bad you couldn't walk through the house unless you stayed on a narrow path that zigzagged through the forest of junk. I hoped everyone knew not to throw away Dad's computer or any of his computer magazines, or the cornucopia popcorn maker, or his vintage board games. Myron knew what to save and what to throw out, but did everybody else? The plan was for Myron to get the cleanup crew started right at 4 o'clock. He'd fill as many truckloads as he could, but he promised to return to his shop at 6 o'clock. He and Mrs. Crumple had it all arranged. She was going to call him at his shop before 4 o'clock. He'd answer the phone in the front room. They'd leave the line open so Myron could hear when I was introduced. Mrs. Crumple said it wouldn't be before 6:15. Myron had Beethoven's greatest hits on turntable ready to play. Mrs. Crumple had a transistor radio tuned to 88.1 FM sitting on the piano behind a large bust of Beethoven. I looked at Dad in the back row. He had a gloomy, faraway look in his eye. I knew he was miserable sitting in that sweltering church hall. He would have been happier at home protecting his stuff. It was only then, as I sat waiting for my turn at the piano, that I realized what an awful mistake this was. What a terrible trick. I knew in that moment how devastated Dad would be when he discovered that Myron and the others had thrown away his collectibles. Sure, maybe to Myron they were unredeemables, but to Dad they were treasures. To Dad, even a leaning tower of moldy pizza boxes was valuable. It was all Myron's fault. If only he'd kept selling Dad the unredeemables for $5 a box, our house wouldn't be such a disaster. Broken clock radios don't stink or take up much room, not as much as junk from the dump did. And if Myron hadn't cooked up that ridiculous radio seance, Dad would never have started going to the junkyard looking for motorcycle parts. No, it was Miss Turnipson's fault. If she hadn't entered Dennis Akers in that stupid contest, no one would have cared what our house looked like. But really, it was Mrs. Crumple's fault. She never should have suggested such a cruel-hearted trick. How would she like it if someone threw away her piano? And then there was Mom. If only she hadn't left. If only she hadn't given Dad that ultimatum about the splinter. She knew how hard it was for him to get rid of things. What if someone in the cleanup crew threw away Dad's holy splinter? There was no telling where Dad had it squirreled away. If someone threw it out, Dad would freak. He would flip. He would crack. And whose fault would it be? Mine. Because we were a team, Dad and me. It was us against them. He was counting on me, and I'd let him down. He would never forgive me for taking part in this treacherous plot. I would have put an end to it right then if I could have. I would have yelled stop at the top of my lungs if I thought it would do any good, but it was too late. Myron and his crew probably had two pickup trucks filled with Dad's stuff already. The plan was in motion. This grand scheme that had grown bigger than all of us was already stirring the atmosphere, rearranging the molecules in some big and mysterious way. I could feel the terrifying intensity in the air, and I could feel it tingling in my fingertips. When Mrs. Crumple called my name, I took a deep, sick breath and walked to the piano. I sat on the bench and placed my fingers lightly on the keys. A tense silence followed as I watched Mrs. Crumple turn on the radio with her thumbnail. She nudged the microphone gently in the direction of the tiny speaker. As the simple melody began to play on the radio, I hunched my back in an attempt to hide my hands. I wasn't even close to replicating the correct fingering, but no one was laughing or giggling or pointing or even paying attention. I glanced out into the audience and saw a lot of closed eyes and cardboard fans flapping in front of hot faces. For 3 long minutes, I pretended to play for Elise. And then, when the song was almost over, it happened. The music cut off. It was replaced by the sound of static, a high hum, and these words, spoken by what sounded like a robot. This is the emergency broadcast system. The National Weather Service has issued a tornado warning for the following counties in Missouri, Barry, Lawrence, and Newton. At 5:45 p.m., a tornado was spotted in southeast Oklahoma moving toward the Missouri border. This is not a test.